answer a discussion regarding GS2 bilateral relation questions. Question number 9. If the last few decades were of Asia's growth story, the next few are expected to be of Africa's. In the light of this statement, examine India's influence in Africa in the recent years. So the question is regarding in this century, the last few 4 or 5 decades, the Asian countries like India, China, so these countries showed growth and development. So now they are telling that the coming few decades, the next 4 or 5 decades is going to be Africa's turn. Okay, particularly why they are telling this, because in Africa, the growth rate of African countries are increasing. FDA increases, investment in African countries have considerably increased. And Africa is a resource-rich countries. Okay, so Africa have all the capacity to become a developed nation. So in the coming decades, Africa is going to be the growth rate of Africa is going to be very, very high. Okay, the important question is, examine India's influence in Africa in the recent years. So what are India's contribution? How India influences Africa? We have this. So first we can bring down this Pan-African E-Network. So to fill up the digital gaps in regarding information technology, India have taken this initiative, Pan-African E-Network. And then we have also have one more initiative called Indian Technical and Economic Cooperation Initiative. And then regarding maritime cooperation also, we are having a good influence over the African countries. We are having an association called IORA, Indian Ocean Rim Association countries. In security, in development, etc., we are cooperating with all the African nations. And Indian diaspora are there, in particular in East African nation and also in South Africa. So they also influence those countries with respect to India. And then in non-alignment movement also, India and the African countries are cooperating with each other very closely. And then one important initiative is this Asia-Africa Growth Corridor. So along with Japan, we are trying to counter the Belt and Road issue, the Silk Road, a maritime road, initiative. Okay, so for Africa, connecting Africa, South India, or South Asia, Southeast Asian countries and Japan. So we are developing maritime infrastructure corridors. And then obviously the medical diplomacy. So India is helping all these countries with respect to COVID vaccines. We are helping them directly, bilaterally, and also through United Nations. So these are all India's influence in Africa. Question number 10. The USA is facing an existential threat in the form of China. This is much more challenging than the erstwhile Soviet Union. Explain. So this is regarding they are trying to compare Cold War with the new Cold War. Cold War was between US and USSR, the Soviet Union, and USSR finally collapsed in 1990. But more than the threat posed by Soviet Union over USA, now in the new Cold War, China is posing more threat towards USA. Why? So just we have to compare the capacity of Soviet Union and today's China with respect to USA. So that will give the answer. So the biggest challenge faced by US is in 4 areas we can see. So number 1, with respect to Soviet Union took ideology, military as a used these two mechanisms. They stressed on these two things only, that is communist ideology and also its military. It focused too much on this. But whereas China, you have to note that although it is a communist country, it is giving more importance to technological and other growth models and also military budgets. Whereas USSR only depended on ideology and military, whereas China is going for growth models also. Economically also, it is building itself. Okay. And then second, openly regarding economy, the Soviet Union had an isolated economy. It did not have big trade relationship with world countries. Whereas China, you have to note that China's economy is integrated with the world. And most importantly, China is the world's largest exporter. China is earning huge amount of foreign currencies from all other countries because of its surplus exports. And China is having almost all raw materials and it is having a very skilled population. So China, that's why, is connected with the entire world countries very closely, complexly interconnected. And then coming to the geopolitics, we have to note that the Soviet Union's politics completely failed. Because it completely relied on hard power alone. Okay. And in many areas, Soviet Union was not able to win over USA. But whereas China, you have to note that it is also a hard power, but at the same time, it is also using diplomacy and also other strategic like checkbook diplomacy, etc., like that, giving money, using economy to control other world countries. Particularly after US withdrawal from Afghanistan and US incapability to do anything against North Korea, we can clearly say that China has won over US, in particular in Afghan crisis and also in North Korean crisis. These two things clearly shows that in geopolitics, China is ahead than US, whereas Soviet Union, with respect to all other problems during the Cold War, Soviet Union failed with respect to USA. In terms of capacity, Russia mainly depend upon its military and oil, but whereas China, you have to note that its capacity in terms of technology, in terms of population, in terms of connectivity with the world, China is having more advantage than Russia. That is so former Soviet Union. So China is more challenging to US than Soviet Union was challenging to US. Question number 19, critically examine the aims and objectives of SCO and what important does it holds for India. So first we have to find out the objectives of SCO and we have to critically examine why the objectives of SCO is not going in lines. For example, one of the main objectives of Shanghai Cooperation Organization is regional cooperation. Okay, against the Western country, China dominated, a China led coalition called Shanghai Cooperation Organization is there. But you have to note that in this group, India is there, Pakistan is there, China, Russia is there. So this alliance may not work well because India, Pakistan are having different understanding. Particularly India and China are also having different interests. How this alliance will make regional cooperation? So this is a major question. So the main objective of SCO itself is something looking difficult. And second is compacting terrorism is another objective of Shanghai Cooperation Organization. But with respect to the recent the developments in Afghanistan and also this ISIS, clearly we can say that the Shanghai Cooperation Organization is the objective of combating terrorism and what China is doing with respect to recognizing Taliban, China and Pakistan and also Russia and India's interest regarding Afghanistan completely is not compatible. And third one, peace and security. So Shanghai Cooperation Organization, one of the main objectives is peace and security. But here you see China's, on seeing the China's record, China is a belligerent growing power, superpower. And China's involvement in the Taiwan crisis and also in Hong Kong crisis clearly shows that Shanghai Cooperation Organization, what China is doing under peace and security is not compatible. And with respect to trade, commerce, tourism and culture, you have to note that although some cooperation can be met, but yet in Belt and Road Initiative, India is not joining Chinese initiative. Okay, and also in COVID-19 situation also, a difference of opinions were there between India and China. So clearly, these things clearly shows that the objectives of Shanghai Cooperation Organization and what is really happening is completely not compatible. And what is India's importance? Why India have to be in SCO? That we have to find out. So point number one, we can engage with China and Russia together in the same forum. And then two, we can have link to the Eurasian region. And to combat terrorism, this can be used. India tactically have to develop certain methods. Diplomatically, we have to handle the China and Pakistan and other countries. And we have to combat terrorism. And then in energy security also, this may be very, very helpful. And finally, cultural connect also is possible. So that's why India have to be with Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Question number 20, the tri-nation partnership, AUKUS, is aimed at countering China's ambition in the Indo-Pacific region. Is it going to supersede the existing partnership in the region? Discuss the strength and impact of AUKUS in the present scenario. See, AUKUS is a tri-national partnership, a security partnership, defense partnership agreement between Australia, UK, and also with the US. Okay. So the ultimate objective is to Australia and US are in another initiative called Quad, in which India and Japan are also members. So this Quad's ultimate objective is to counter China in the Indo-Pacific region, not to allow China to have a foothold or dominate Indian Ocean and Pacific Ocean. On the other side, by having this trilateral partnership, in AUKUS, US and Australia are bringing UK into the Indo-Pacific Regency. So this is the major achievement. Okay, so one more powerful country, UK, is also there along with the US and Australia, who are partners with India and Quad to counter China. So the first question is it going to supersede the existing partnership in the region? Whether AUKUS is going to supersede Quad? This is question number one. We can argue in both the ways. So one, we can say that the two of the Quad members were not members in AUKUS. So this we can see it as a setback. One, that means particularly this AUKUS is mainly to share the submarine technology. The submarine technology is denied to India and Japan. So this we can see it as a setback. And then two, this AUKUS may weak the already formed a group called Five Eyes Alliance, along with Australia, New Zealand, US, they are having a group. This AUKUS is undermining that idea. And moreover, most importantly, France is having a lot of reservation towards this AUKUS. And because this AUKUS is formed, the regional stability also may not go well, because China may feel offended. When China will increase its presence in Indo-Pacific region, this may go against India. So all these things clearly shows that this AUKUS to some extent is superseding Quad. But on the other side, the Quad partners of India, Australia and US, they are equipping themselves against China along with the new power UK. The credible deterrence against China is increasing, particularly with respect to Australia. Okay, the enemies of China are coming together. So definitely we can say that if China and India are going for a problem tomorrow, means we are Quad and the extended Quad, this is AUKUS. If they are strong, means it is good for India and we can deter China. So definitely AUKUS completely is not outsmarting the Quad's achievement. AUKUS is actually giving more meaning to Quad and more that means more supportive to Quad move. And the impacts on AUKUS, see, this strengthens Australia and Australia's relationship with the US and UK, and obviously Australia's capacity. Australia now can access to artificial intelligence and also long range missile capabilities and also submarine technology. Okay, and since AUKUS and Quad are overlapping, obviously it is a big threat for China, and China have to. And China, that's why what China is doing is China is reacting too much with respect to the Taiwan issue, creating problem with Japan, which is a partner to India in Quad. Okay, now China is facing a very powerful new defense alliance. Already Quad, four countries are there: India, Japan, US and Australia. Now in another form, Australia, UK and US. So this is definitely a big deterrence for China.